Robin Hood Radio and the Robin Hood Radio Network is proud to present Leonard Lopate at Large, lively hour-long in-depth discussions providing overviews and context to topics usually covered in partial measures. His guests include leading thinkers, scientists, artists, economists, farmers, historians, authors, and politicians. Mr. Lopate is a Peabody Award winner whose numerous honors include 3 Associated Press Awards and 3 James Beard Awards.
Welcome to Leonard Lopate at Large. I'm Leonard Lopate. Although the fall of Saigon was still 7 years off, John Murphy says the war effort in Vietnam was already a mess when he arrived in 1967. Military intelligence had collapsed, the Viet Cong had infiltrated the American spy network, and the U.S. could not rely on the South Vietnamese. Mr. Murphy served as an elite officer, analyst, and operative for the Army, CIA, and South Vietnamese intelligence services that year, and he describes what he saw and did in a new CalLamp Films release written, produced, and directed by Michael Ryder called Agents Unknown. John Murphy and Michael Ryder join us now. Welcome to our show.
Thanks very much, Leonard.
Mike, let's begin with you. Wasn't your previous film about auto racing? This seems like a far cry from that.
That's funny. It is a far cry, and you know, these kind of projects come up. If there's an interesting story, I can't pick and choose really. So it's from auto racing to, you know, Vietnam. Why not?
John, what were you doing before you were sent to Vietnam?
Well, I had recently graduated from college and was actually in graduate school at the University of Chicago. I had delayed my entrance into the Army since I had been commissioned as an officer with ROTC background. And in May of 1966, my educational deferment was up, and it was time to do my duty for the next 2 years.
And were you a supporter of the war?
Not really. As a graduate student in political science, I'd had the opportunity to study under Professor Hans Morgenthau, one of the great political thinkers in international relations, and I really sort of adopted his philosophy about the questions of the national interest and whether or not this war was really in the interests of the United States. But I had concluded, differently from many of my friends and colleagues, that I couldn't reject the commitment I'd made far back as 1962, when I first entered ROTC, that I had the right to refuse to serve. I thought the war was wrong, but I didn't think it was morally offensive.
Mike, before we get into the fascinating story you tell in this film, can you tell me how you were able to obtain all of the amazing footage, the documents and the photographs that you include? Had it all been shot by the U.S. military?
Pardon me?
Had it all been shot by the U.S. military?
Yes, the footage was all U.S. military footage. And so most of that, I would say probably half of it was through National Archives, and the other half was through a company that provided stock footage, but it's all government footage. They were basically just a middleman that provided masters. So it was all military, and then of course there was additional. John had took amazing photos and had great documents, letters, and things like that. And then, additionally, I got some photos. There's a story about an accident that happened involving the Vietnamese and an explosion. And so I was able to get photos related to that through a third party. And so, you know, there were a handful of sources, but most of it was through archives and publicly accessible venues.
How do you know each other?
So actually, I know John. I've known John my whole life. He's a longtime family friend, and I had known that he had been in the war, but I didn't really know what he did. And then I had heard some anecdotes and stories that he told one time, and I thought it would be an interesting project and an interesting angle on the war.
And was it clear from the start that the stories he had to tell were unlike what we normally heard about the Vietnam War? You're telling a different story here than Ken Burns told in his long series about the war.
Well, I did, going into it and raising the money and stuff, that was a big question because there were lots of Vietnam War documentaries, obviously, before that. And so the question was, what's the new angle or new, what will make this interesting to people? And so hearing about it and researching other films that hadn't, there didn't seem to be anything like it, and that something that went to, that followed just one person's story, other than the one thing I can think of is Fog of War from Errol Morris, where it's just one person and an interview based around that. So that was the idea. I did some research and went for it.
And
I could just add that I'm a great admirer of Ken Burns' documentary, but one of the things that I think has been overlooked has been, not my role, but the role of the advisors in Vietnam. Most of the film is based on my account of having been assigned to advise the South Vietnamese at the local province level, and that part of the war has not had the kind of attention which, and rightly so, that the major battles which American forces engaged in, which dominates much of the Ken Burns documentary, for example.
By the time when you arrived, reports from Vietnam were generally encouraging, but wasn't the situation already a mess at that point?
Well, that's what I was certainly going to discover. I entered the combat zone, if we call it that, in late 1966, and really having only had two months of Army infantry training and 6 weeks of a combat intelligence course that the Army gave, which was all based on the Korean War. By the time I got there, I was there to learn and to figure out what it was I was going to be doing and what the status of the war was. And as you suggest, that it didn't take very long to realize that some of the reports from some of the great reporting that had been done by David Halberstam and others was probably correct, that there was a problem at the core of the effort. And that involved the willingness of the South Vietnamese and their army to actually engage in the effort.
Considering the messy situation, were you surprised that the war wound up lasting as long as it did?
Yeah, it really was a shock that when I returned and actually was back in graduate school by the time that the war eventually ended, it seemed unfathomable that it could have gone on as long as it did and that it would end in the way that it did. I'm not sure that I had any prognostication about how it was going to end, but I certainly didn't think it was going to last that long.
You seem to have had many different assignments, not just gathering intelligence, but even going on a bank run at one point. Simply say, this needs to be done, John? Go and do it?
Well, that's what my commanding officer said. You're the junior officer, so you get this assignment. Essentially, it's kind of fascinating that, at least in my day, the Army was very conscientious about trying to get everybody paid on or near as possible to their regular payday. And because I was dealing with people who were, for the most part, living on the local economy, that is, advisors who lived in and among the Vietnamese and needed to oftentimes interact with them in the marketplace and other ways, it was important for them to get what I'll call it cash, but were either the Army's military payment certificates or the Vietnamese currency that we call piastres. And so it turned out to be that three times during my tour there, I wound up being responsible for flying to Saigon, picking up a bag of money somewhere between $10,000 and $20,000 and flying around in a single-engine plane with a pilot to various locations in order to make sure that the advisors got their money as close to payday as possible.
And then once you were shut down?
Well, the actual incident was in a rather obscure advisory place off the main area of Bamituit. I found that there were three advisors who were literally living underground because each night there was a North Vietnamese battalion in the area that rained mortar fire on them. And when we got to the location, the pilot told me that it was difficult to find out where we were going to land. There didn't seem to be any landing strip. He finally realized that it was going to be a hillside and that we would fly and land going up the hill. But in taking off again, we needed to take off going down the hill. Mm-hmm. And as we did that, there was a good deal of air problems, wind problems, and we got about 200 feet in the air and then came crashing back down. And it was there that I had to worry about, as I jumped out of the plane, how was I going to get the money that I'd left behind in the plane in case it caught fire?
I'm not going to, we won't reveal what happened because we do want people to see the film. A lot of this story involves the structure of the military hierarchy, and you say it was, you saw it as an organizational problem. Also that bad intelligence goes up the chain of command to become policy.
Yeah, there are several ways of thinking about that, but one of the things that struck me, especially as I look back on that experience, was the extent to which the U.S. military seemed to think that we could change the motivation of our counterparts, the Army of Vietnam, if we could get them into the right organizational structure. So, for example, in the area of intelligence, there were concerns that we were not able to get the Vietnamese to share information among their different services. At my province in Phan Rang, Ninh Thuan province, we had both Army and Naval elements. We had National Police, and we had other kinds of organizations that had some piece of the intelligence pie, but they didn't talk to each other. And one of the things that the film Agents Unknown, the title comes from the fact that for much of the time, in fact, for all of the time I was there, we were never able to really coordinate the question of who these people were. And the problem that meant for intelligence, just as it might be for anybody trying to collect information, is that you couldn't tell whether or not the source of the information was A, reliable, or B, not the same person was selling the information to another service, so that you were getting information that was supposedly being corroborated, but really was simply the same story being told by the same person. So we had a number of those issues, and the military's response to that was, how can we get these people to work together and share information so that we can get a better product? And that was always a very difficult, if not impossible, task.
Mike, you provide a number of organizational charts throughout the film. They get fairly complicated. Were they supplied by the U.S. military?
So those were indirectly, yes. So a number of those were through archival research, basically archival research. So I didn't ask the military directly for any of that stuff. It was all through archives or military publications that were public domain that just had this stuff. Or additionally, actually, most of it was through military manuals. So I dug up old
army manuals or got them on eBay and from the period, obviously. And so, yeah, they would have the army loves charts and diagrams and little boxes with names in them. And so I thought it worked out for from a graphics point of view.
On the other hand, it also reveals that there were, it was really an invitation for a lot of confusion. Now, you mentioned, John, that all of this was inherited to some degree from what happened during World War II and the Korean War. Did the military...
Well, I was saying that the only information, the only training that I'd had and what I was going to be doing in Vietnam had been based on educational materials at the Army Intelligence School, all of which used as examples the Korean War. So it had absolutely no relevance to anything that was to come into my playing. In fact, when I returned from Vietnam, I taught at the Military Intelligence School. That was at Fort Halliburton in Maryland at the time. And I actually wrote the first block of instruction that was actually based on Vietnam, so that the people that I taught at least had some better idea of what kind of issues they were going to be facing.
So did things change much after you left and after Richard Nixon replaced Lyndon Johnson as president?
I doubt if there was much change. I think the when Nixon, of course, developed his Vietnamization policy to turn over more responsibility to the ARVN, to the Army of Vietnam, I think the die was cast. I think those of us who'd been there and worked with them knew that this was not going to be an effort that could likely result in anything known as a victory.
I'm speaking with John Murphy about his experiences in Vietnam as an intelligence officer, and with Michael Ryder, who's made a film with him called Agents Unknown. Michael, how can people see this film?
Well, it's available on Amazon Prime Video, and it's also available on video on demand cable. So someone, if they have a cable box, they can watch it on that as well.
When you were talking with John about his experiences, were you as surprised as the viewer is by so many of the things that he revealed?
Yes, I was. And I did know a fair amount about the war in broad strokes, like a lot of people my age. And I did know, in a very general way, the intelligence problems, because I have an interest in intelligence and espionage and spies and all that. But I didn't really know any of the details of that and how it played out in terms of the battles and how everything was connected. Like a lot of people, you know, a big part of my knowledge of the war is from popular culture and movies and stuff, which is mostly deals with almost entirely with combat and such. So I did not know all of that, and it was fascinating to learn more.
You couldn't have known about some of the funny details, John. The code name that people were assigned, you were, what, Silver Lightning Alpha 2?
Alpha, right, Alpha 2 Alpha. Sometimes said Alpha 2 and sometimes 2 Alpha, meaning that I was an assistant in the intelligence. In the Army parlance, an S2 is the intelligence officer. It might be useful if I gave a little bit of background on how that occurs and the whole advisory team that we worked with. Each of the 44 provinces in South Vietnam was really governed by the Army of Vietnam, with a province chief who is a colonel in the Army. And the U.S. Army replicated that with the advisory team, so that the commander of my advisory team, number 39, was a colonel. And we replicated the officers, S1, S2, S3, all down the line, and we had counterparts then with the provincial government. And so as an S2, an intelligence officer, I worked with the intelligence officers of the Vietnamese Army who were assigned to that province. And that gave me access to much of the local things that were going on. The province I was in was primarily one that was involved in the sort of war of national liberation. We had Viet Cong units who stayed for the most part up in the mountain areas and would come down at night and infiltrate a hamlet, conduct an indoctrination session, sometimes assassinate the hamlet chief, and then retreat back to the mountains during the day. So it was a matter of trying to locate the enemy and to get the Vietnamese forces. We had no American forces under our command. We worked only with the Vietnamese army, which constituted both the regular army and then two local units that we might compare to our National Guard. There were the regional forces and the popular forces that we called the Roughhouse. And those were local people who were armed primarily to defend their own areas at night.
You've said that the United States didn't want to be seen as a colonial ruler. I'm assuming what you're describing now was seen as a way of conducting the war effort without being seen as a colonial warrior, a ruler.
Well, that's right. I mean, really from the very beginning, although there was no training on this, one could see the effort to try to establish a governing connection between the local Vietnamese officers or their government, what we'd call their government, and the people. So, for example, we would never give rice that came from the United States directly to people in the hamlets. It would always go to the district chief or the province chief, and they would have the responsibility for distributing it, thereby hoping to, I guess, that the people would see a connection between their government and some kind of useful service. So the whole colonial issue was one, I think, that came up as myself and several of my colleague officers discussed the war. We saw so many occasions when it seemed to us that the United States should simply tell the Vietnamese, this is what we're going to do, and not simply leave it to us to try to persuade them to do things. And that led to a lot of tension. And the underlying problem there, it seemed, was that we did not want to appear to be simply the French replacing the French, I should say, as colonial rulers. And I think the kind of conclusion I would come to was that if we had wanted to, quote, win that war, the United States would have had to have become the colonial ruler. And, of course, in that sense, it never could win the war.
How about now? Do you see any similarities in the way the operations in Afghanistan, Iraq, and Syria have been run? All of those countries also had been colonized by European countries at one point or another.
Absolutely. You know, this is one of the things which Michael has drawn attention to, although subtly in the film. This is a film talking about some issues that are absolutely relevant to these recent experiences over the last 10 or 20 years in those areas, Iraq, Afghanistan, and the like. I've had occasion since the film has come out to meet a number of people who engaged in intelligence work in Iraq and Afghanistan, and they are stunned by the similarities between my experiences and the ones that they had, trying to cultivate information from a local population which is estranged from the occupying power and which is not necessarily to be trusted all the time.
Mike,
I think there are some strong connections there.
And Mike, in talking about the film with interviewers and at presentations, are people seeing that connection as well?
Yes, I think it comes up pretty clearly. And at the end, well, there's throughout the beginning and end of the film, there's stuff that ties it in and also to some degree throughout. So, yeah, I think it seems pretty clear from what the interviewers have said.
I mentioned earlier, John, that you had a code name. Why give you a code name? And you tell this hilarious story about how it was blown when your son was born.
Right. We had a lot of those kinds of incidents where we attempted to. The story is that I had left my newly wed wife 1 month pregnant when I was sent to Vietnam, and so in the month of June I was anticipating the birth of our first child, and I happened to be out in what we called the field in an operation which, let me just sidetrack that for a moment to give you an example of some of the problems we faced. This was after weeks of encouraging the Vietnamese to conduct some kind of search operation around areas of the province that were considered near or in VC territory. We got this operation established, and I asked my interpreter to check with people around the area to see what they thought of this. And he came back to me, says, well, he says, you're not going to like this. I said, well, what is? He says, they say they do this every year. It's to protect the province chief brother's rice plantation. So that's what we were doing. But anyway, so I get a call on the radio, and this a radio operator completely blows the security code by telling me that my son, John James Murphy, the junior, has been born. So,
but nobody knew that that was your name?
Not over the radio. I mean, obviously they knew, my colleagues knew it, and the Vietnamese knew it, but no one is supposed to conduct that kind of information over radio communications or more broadly.
And what is the reason for that? Obviously, they weren't going to go to Chicago and find your family, and especially if the name is Murphy.
That's a good point. There are an awful lot of Murphys to trek through. The idea is some kind of throwback to security. The idea that somehow, some way, that information could be useful to the enemy. Even though you are permitted, even if you're a prisoner of war, to give your name, rank, and serial number, but not over the radio.
I'm speaking with John Murphy, whose story is told in a new film by Michael Ryder called Agents Unknown. This is Leonard Lopate at Large. So much of this story is about trust, which was hard won and easily lost. Isn't that always the issue in intelligence gathering?
Well, it certainly is an important feature. I think if we think about our contemporary world, the question is, what are real facts? You know, what is the truth? And obviously, trust in the source of information is the most important of many ingredients. There sometimes are other ways to confirm information. So, for example, if we got a report that there was a Viet Cong unit moving through a certain area, we could send our aerial observer over that area to see if there were any signs of such activity, so that you could reinforce the accuracy of the information. But for the most part, the reports would be delayed, and so you had to know who the source of the information was and whether that person or people had proved to be reliable in the past, which gave us some degree of trust in the information that they were providing.
Was Vietnam a special case? You were not only dealing with the Vietnamese military, the ARVN, but also indigenous peoples like the Montagnards and the Mun, who speak a variety of different languages, each with a unique cultural sensibility.
Absolutely. The area that I was in did have a mixture of Montagnard and Hmong in the area, and one of the stories which is in the film is a bit about that kind of clash of cultures between the Americans and indigenous people. Story is about an area that was predominantly Montagnard and had a Vietnamese captain or major who was the district chief. We used to go to these areas and try to assure that the local forces, as I mentioned before, the regional and the popular forces, were getting the supplies that they needed, which the Americans could help supply. Obviously, through the district chief. We went out to a couple of different hamlets in that area, and the members of the popular forces, who were often these older men who had very old weapons that they would use at night to guard the hamlet, and they were complaining that they didn't get enough to eat, that they weren't getting the rice that we supposedly were supplying. After some further investigation, we were able to determine that the district chief must have been siphoning off some of the rice, probably selling it on the black market or for his own use. We then conducted what turned out to be a rather lengthy campaign to get rid of him, that this was a corrupt district chief and that we couldn't countenance that. Eventually, as the way of the military in the Vietnamese sector operated, we managed to get him promoted to their command and general staff college, which at least got him out of the district. Well, going along with this, we had a ceremony which was to be his leaving of the district. And as we came into the area where he was going to be making his final goodbyes, I noticed that a number of the Montagnards were coming down from the mountains, and some of them were literally crying. And I asked the interpreter to go around and find out what was their feeling about thing. Well, he came back. He said, you know, they said this is the best district chief they've ever had. This guy had been helpful to them in developing charcoal kilns and ways of getting into a little bit of marketplace work. And there was the first Vietnamese that they'd ever worked with that had been somewhat helpful to him. So I had to go back to my colonel and say, you know, we should have just been paying him directly to stay in the job. Instead, knowing that America had to have clean hands, we decided to get rid of this corrupt individual.
Well, obviously, different people had different senses of priorities. But but the story also reveals something else, that the Vietnamese military were actually a different, ethnic group than the Montagnards and the Mun. We tend to think of the Vietnamese as one kind of people, but not only different languages, but easily spotted. They look different.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. The Montagnards were of a much darker complected and easily recognizable as distinct from the native Vietnamese. And while they were, again, a minority, they were nevertheless prevalent in certain areas, in the mountain areas. For the most part, especially, and I don't know this from personal experience, but the U.S. Army Special Forces had particular success in working with the Montagnards in forming defensive groups in certain areas. They weren't in my area, but they were people that were generally considered by the American forces to be friendly.
Now, corruption seems to have been endemic on nearly every level. When did you begin to realize that you had to be suspicious of nearly everyone?
Well, the naivete of an American not long out of college going to another country, it took a little while. We had one particularly climactic event when a small group of these regional popular forces had stopped an Army of Vietnam truck that was proceeding into an area that was considered to be Viet Cong controlled. And in the truck, they found boxes of American medical supplies. The only reason why that would be happening was that they were going to be either given to the Viet Cong or sold to the Viet Cong. So these people, the Vietnamese regional forces, were offered bribes to let the driver go and forget about this, more money than they would have seen in their lives, but they didn't do it. And eventually I was assigned to go to find out what was going on. We got to the truck. The driver was taken under arrest. And as we traced back the origins of that particular truck, we found it had been assigned to the Vietnamese Army major, whom we considered, that is, we, the American forces, considered perhaps the most professional of all of the Vietnamese that we dealt with. He was well-trained. He was, we thought, perfectly committed to the cause. And instead, we had to come to the conclusion that he probably had ordered this and was, in fact, corruptly selling American supplies to the enemy. So once you reach that point, you begin not to trust anybody, really.
And since you say it's a matter of knowing your enemy, that seems almost impossible.
Well, it's very difficult. One of the efforts that the American force, if you think about my role as an advisor, really was twofold. It was, you know, first of all, operating on the idea that a 23-year-old American could advise some of my Vietnamese counterparts who'd been fighting this war since the French left, that I could contribute much to them. It was somewhat unrealistic. But the other role was, of course, to collect as much of the information that they had and move it through American circles, moving it up to our command structure, and particularly to Saigon, where, of course, the major decisions about the war were being made. And it happened that many of my colleagues who had been in the Army Intelligence School training with me had wound up in Saigon, in Tan Son Nhut Air Base, where the major headquarters for the entire effort was placed. And they were the ones that were designing the large maps and doing the major collection of information that eventually was to go to Washington. And so at one point, we received an order that we were to try to identify, to the extent possible, the number of Vietnamese civilians who were actually cooperating with the enemy. That is the so-called Viet Cong infrastructure. As we learned, the Viet Cong had really developed a kind of shadow government in each province. They had an individual who was considered to be their province chief. They had people in the hamlets who were their sources of information. And our job was to try to put some kind of a number on the possible numbers of people that were playing these kinds of roles. Well, it turned out that the Vietnamese had been ordered through their command as well to come up with these numbers. And at one point, we submitted the numbers that we came to partly based upon some captured documents that we had found and that had been taken by some U.S. forces. And we came up with a number of so-called Vietnamese infrastructure. We sent those up the line eventually to Saigon. The problem was that the Vietnamese came up with a much lower figure. And the colonel who commanded my team called me in one day and said, you know, I've got this communication from the division headquarters saying that our numbers don't match those of the Vietnamese. and we ought to reconcile them. So we went to the Vietnamese and we argued our position as to why we came up with our number. They smiled and nodded and declined to change their numbers in any way. So we sent our numbers back up the line, and a few days later, the colonel again got another communication saying that these numbers were not compatible with the Vietnamese and that we needed to find a figure that was. And the colonel asked me what I thought, and unfortunately I said, I think they want the Vietnamese figures because we've already made the case for why we think ours are correct. Well, so what happened is we sent the lower figures up and everybody was happy. I had occasion then to go to Saigon, where I met with my friends who were in the Vietnamese order of battle business, meaning that they were maintaining these large maps with numbers, and they showed me what was the result of the numbers I'd submitted. And I said, well, you've got a beautiful map there, and I know your numbers are nice. I said, there's only one problem. I know I sent you the numbers, and they're wrong. But those were the numbers that went up to Washington. And so, if you remember, there was a great flap about whether just General Westmoreland was fudging the figures about the size of the enemy. My position has always been that he didn't need to, because we were being ordered at the local level to fudge them to begin with.
So you were juggling U.S. military culture with the Vietnamese military culture, and then the Vietnamese governmental culture and the Vietnamese civilian culture.
Absolutely.
That's a lot of juggling. You also said that you couldn't get the Vietnamese military to do anything. Didn't they want to win the war?
No, I mean, this is, again, going back to my point about organization, that somehow the military thought that if we could get them organized correctly, they'd be more motivated to fight. But they really weren't. Even at this mid stage of what became, until Afghanistan, our longest war, the question of motivation was simply not there. And if part of it was the betrayal by some in the Vietnamese military. I remember talking to one of the local forces that, I said, at some point, you know, the Americans are going to leave. What are you going to do if the Viet Cong win? And this middle-aged gentleman said, I'll go to the mountains. I'll fight them from there. Mm-hmm. Now, some of that had to do with religion. The Catholic population in Vietnam, while a minority, was nevertheless more strongly anti-communist, and I think that's why, to some extent, the American military liked to rely on those who were religiously affiliated with the Catholic Church. But a lot of it was that there were people who really did want to resist a takeover from those communist forces. But that was not enough to really strengthen the entire effort, that it was not deep enough ingrained in much of the Vietnamese military to make that the case that they could fight this war with the kind of ferocity that they would have had to have done.
And obviously it didn't happen after the fall of
Saigon. It did not.
In some cases, wasn't it understandable when Vietnamese villagers shot at U.S. planes because of the way we had been using Agent Orange?
Well, that's, it's another kind of tragedy, tragic story that, and it goes back to our discussion about the Montagnards. There were areas of the province that were highly mountainous and often covered with clouds, so that even our aerial observers were often not able to get up to see what was going on. But the Montagnards in those areas operated what we called slash-and-burn farming. They would burn off an area on the side of a hill or mountain, and you could see where they had planted things. So we knew that there were people up there, but we didn't know much about them. One story was that nobody, had, no American or no Westerner had been in that area since the French left. But we had never had any problems in flying over their territory when we could. But along one day came a group of Air Force pilots wearing orange fluorescent scarves who identified themselves as the people who did administer the Agent Orange. And the colonel that commanded our team had decided that it would be useful to somehow clear off some of the mountainous areas where these Montagnards were, and Agent Orange was, in fact, dropped upon them, defoliating large areas.
And leading later to people getting cancer, among other things. It's a Agent Orange.
It's been a terrible scourge, yeah, a terrible scourge for many veterans, where it was not the case in my unit. Many of the regular American units were ordered into areas shortly after the defoliation and consequently absorbed some of that chemical that has produced long-lasting damage to them. It's a great tragedy.
Were you generally happy?
In this case, it was just that when we finally did fly up into those areas again after we had dropped Agent Orange, we for the first time began to receive rifle fire from below. The colonel said to me, "See, I told you they were VC up there." And, of course, I said, "You know, well, if you had just been hit with Agent Orange, you'd probably shoot at the next plane to come over, too."
Were you generally okay with your recommendations as to whether we should bomb an area or a village?
For the most part, yeah. One of the things that bothered me and continues to be some of a nagging concern was that we were located near Fenrang Air Base, out of which flew some of the Air Force planes that were bombing in the north or in I Corps. And, excuse me, when they came back having unexpended loads of weapons, bombs, they would often ask for what we called targets of opportunity. Were there areas that we could identify where they could, instead of dropping their bombs into the ocean, could try to hit something that might be Viet Cong areas? And again, we were, for the most part, we never targeted anything near any of the local civilian populations. But in areas that were considered under Viet Cong control, some you may have heard of as free fire zones, you really never knew what the targets hit were, who might have been the victims of some of those expended ordinances.
We have very little time left, but I just want to cover two controversial things, and maybe we could do it rather briefly. The Phoenix program, which was really controversial, and the fact that body count expectations being sent back to the folks in Washington were often inflated. Was this something that you had to deal with?
There were two of those. The Phoenix program, I didn't have direct involvement, at least under that name, but it was the beginning of it. It was an effort, what we called the Combined Intelligence Center Initiative, which was partly the result of that effort to identify Viet Cong infrastructure, that is, civilians who were living in the hamlets who were sympathetic to or working with the Viet Cong. And that effort eventually, some months after I left, those individuals became targets of assassination under the Phoenix program. And while I never had any direct role in that, obviously the accumulation of information while I was there about individuals, although we had very little of any useful information, may have been the early stages of that. With regard to the second point.
Body counts.
I'm sorry?
The body counts.
Yeah, the body counts. The one of the things that was particularly disturbing to me was after a unit of the 101st Airborne had conducted an operation in our area, I went to the briefing, the post-battle briefing, and the first thing that struck me was that the first thing that the commanding officer asked for was a report from the public relations officer wanting to know how many times the unit had been identified in U.S. newspapers back in the home country, which struck me as an odd way to start a military briefing. But it suggests some of the character of the war and of the way in which officers were looking for advancement. The second part of that was, as you suggest, the body count issue. Oftentimes, anyone who was killed was a VC. That was sort of an automatic finding. And in this particular briefing, he was particularly disappointed because the body count in our area had been relatively low. And so you did get the sense that what was driving so many of these operations was the body count issue. He turned around and blamed, myself and my superior officer because they had had and expected a much larger contingent of Viet Cong. And we had to try to explain that those reports that he'd gotten of large numbers were part of the intelligence which we could not confirm and were not really to be used as a basis for an operation. So that the whole plan had been misconceived really from the beginning.
Mike, did you try to do a complete interview in one sitting and try to structure the film along the arc of John's 365-day tour of duty?
Yes. The interview was done in one day, and it was structured around his tour, but also because it's an episodic type of film, and it's based on anecdotes and stories and stuff.
I'm sure you had to cut a few out, too, some really good ones.
Yes, but those will be, eventually the film will be on DVD, and there will be some deleted scenes with, you know, MASH, funny stuff, and other interesting tidbits. But so in addition to working with these episodes, I tried to structure the episodes and anecdotes and stories in such a way that it's not front-loaded or back-loaded with the heavy intelligence information, but that it's more of a mix of the intelligence gathering stuff plus John's personal interactions and so on.
John, did you ever talk to officials in Washington about what was really going on?
Well, again, we actually start the film with an episode after I returned. As I said, I wound up being an instructor at the Army Intelligence School, and it seemed to obviously I became kind of the Vietnam expert. And the school did have a man who was the liaison to the Central Intelligence Agency. And he called me one day and said, you know, this was now in the early stages of the Tet Offensive in 1968. And he said, I'm going to a meeting at the CIA that's supposed to be a briefing about the Tet Offensive. Would you want to come along? And I said, oh, my goodness, that would be wonderful. Sure. So I went to Langley, Virginia, and the still known as an agricultural research center when we drove up, and entered into the sanctum of the Central Intelligence Agency, sitting at a table with a number of superior officers and people from state and other agencies. And in comes the man who evidently was on the Vietnam desk overnight, looking disheveled, but also deeply concerned. As we introduced ourselves, I mentioned that I had been an intelligence advisor at the province level, and someone with a much higher rank than me said, oh, I always wondered what goes on at the province level. And so I had to tell him a little bit about what we did at the province level. In the meantime, the CIA chief indicated in answer to a question that they just didn't know what was happening. Well, of course, I could have told him that at the province level, I knew that the CIA representative, who was at that time, they were advisors to the national police, was probably holed up in his home with his private guards and and a bottle of liquor, and probably not reporting much on what was going on, because that had been our experience with him anyway.
Now,
to be fair to these people, though, they were often being dragged out of their desk jobs in Virginia to become chiefs in Vietnam, and probably didn't have much background in what they were doing.
Mike, where can people see the film again?
Sure. It's at it's on Amazon Prime Video, and if you go to www.agentsunknown.com, there's information about watching it there, and also available on Video On Demand, cable, and those three are the places to go.
Thank you both so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And that brings us to the end of today's show. My great thanks to Michael Breiter and John Murphy, to Charlie Morrow, who composed our theme music, to Reggie Johnson, who was at the audio controls, and to my executive producer, Jesse Lent.
Leonard Lopate at Large comes to you
on Saturdays at 4 and Tuesdays at noon. You can subscribe to Leonard Lopate at Large podcast on iTunes and by clicking on Robin Hood Radio's archive program site, which is robinhoodradio.com. You can also check out Leonard Lopate at Large Facebook page. We hope to see you next week.